The wrong house. Gets it, go. In the dark night, two men slipped quickly through the dark bushes surrounded house. They examined the house. There was a dust like a light snow over everything. Both were lucky that there was none in the house. From the past 10 days, their luck had failed them. How they reached the end, read in this story. The night was dark and the house was dark, dark and silent. The two men ran towards it quietly. They slipped in quickly through the dark bushes which surrounded the house. They reached the porch, ran quickly up the steps, kneeled down, breathing heavily in the dark shadows. They waited, listening. Silence, perfect silence. Then out of the blackness a whisper, "We can't stay out of here. Take this suitcase. Let me try those keys. We have got to get in." 10, 20, 30 seconds. With one of the keys, the one man opened the door. Silently, the two men entered the house, closed the door behind them, locked it. Whispering, they discussed the situation. They wondered if they had awakened anyone in the house. "Let's have a look at this place. Careful, hasty. Oh, there's not anybody awake." And the soft rays of a flashlight swept the room. It was a large room, a living room. Rugs, carefully rolled, lay piled on one side. The furniture, chairs, tables, couches were covered by sheet. Dust lay like a light snow over everything. The man who held the flashlight spoke first. "Well, Blackie," he said, "we are in luck. Look as if the family is away." "Yeah, gone for the summer, I guess. We better make sure, though, huh?" Together they searched the house. They went on tip-top through every room. There could be no doubt about it. The family was away, had been away for weeks. Yes, Husty Hogan and Blackie Burns were in luck. Only once in the past 10 days had their luck failed them. It had been with them when they made their big robbery, their truly magnificent robbery on the coast. It had been with them during their 1,000-mile trip eastward by automobile. It had been with them every moment but one. That moment had just come 1 hour before. It came when Blackie, driving the car, ran over a policeman, and Blackie, thinking of the suitcase at Husty's feet, had driven away swiftly. There had been a chase, of course, a wild crazy chase, and when a bullet had punctured the gasoline tank, they had had to abandon the car. But luck or no luck, here they were, alone and without a car, in a completely strange town, but safe and sound with the suitcase. The suitcase lay in the center of the table, in the center of the room. In the suitcase, neat little package, lay nearly $300,000. "Listen," said Mr. Hogan, "we have to get a car, quick too, and we cannot steal one and use it. It's too dangerous. We have to buy one. That means that we have to wait until the stores open. That will be about 8 o'clock in this town. But what are we going to do with that?" And Mr. Burns pointed to the suitcase. "Hide it right there." "Sure, why not? It's much safer here than with us until we get a car." And so they hid the suitcase. They carried it down to the cellar, buried deep in some coal which lay in the corner of the cellar. After this, just before dawn, they slipped out. "Say, Blackie," Mr. Hogan remarked as they walked down the street, "the name of the gentleman we are visiting is Mr. Samuel W. Rogers." "How do you know?" "So with on some of them books, he surely got a wonderful library, hasn't he?" The automobile sales rooms opened at 8 o'clock, as Mr. Hogan had supposed. Shortly before 9, Mr. Hogan and Mr. Burns had a car, a very nice little car, very quiet, very inconspicuous and very speedy. The dealer lent them his license plates and away they rode. 3 blocks from the house they stopped. Mr. Hogan got out, walked towards the house. He had just to go around to the rear. He thought and slipped in. 50 yards from the house he stopped, stared, swore softly. The front door was open. The window shades were up. The family had returned. Well, what bad luck. And what could they do? Break into the cellar that night and pick up the suitcase? No, too dangerous. Mr. Hogan would have to think of something. "Leave it to me, kid," he told Mr. Burns. "You drive the car. I will do the special brain work. Let's find a telephone, quick." 10 minutes later, Mr. Hogan was consulting a telephone directory. Yes, there it was. Samuel W. Rogers, Plain view 6329. A moment later, he was talking to the surprised Mr. Rogers. Hello, he began. Is this Mr. Rogers? Mr. Samuel Rogers? Yes, this is Mr. Rogers. Mr. Hogan cleared his throat. Mr. Rogers, he said, and his tone was sharp, official, impressive. This is headquarters, police headquarters talking. I'm Simpson, Sergeant Simpson of the detective division. Yes, yes. Came over the wire. The chief of police, you know. Here, Mr. Hogan lowered his voice a little, has ordered me to get in touch with you. He's sending me out with one of our men to see you. Am I in trouble of some kind? Asked Mr. Rogers. No, 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 nothing like that. But I have something of great importance to talk to you about. Very well, came the voice of Mr. Rogers. I will wait for you. And Mr. Rogers, Mr. Hogan cautioned, please keep quiet about this. Don't say anything to anybody. You will understand why when I see you. On the way back to the house, Mr. Hogan explained his idea to Mr. Burns. Within 10 minutes, Sergeant Simpson and Detective Johnson were conversing with the surprised Mr. Rogers. Mr. Rogers was a small man, rather insignificant. He had pale blue eyes, not much of a chin, a funny little face. He was nervous, a badly frightened man. Mr. Hogan told the whole story, somewhat changed, very much changed, and Mr. Rogers was surprised but delighted. He accompanied Mr. Hogan to the cellar, and together they dug up the suitcase, took it to the living room, opened it so that it had not been touched. That it really did hold a small fortune, bills, bills, bills. Mr. Hogan closed the suitcase. And now, Mr. Rogers, he announced in his best official manner, Johnson and must run along. The chief wants a report, quick. We have to catch the rest of the robbers. I will keep in touch with you. He picked up the suitcase and rose. Mr. Burns also rose. Mr. Rogers also rose. The trio walked to the door. Mr. Rogers opened and come in, boys, he said pleasantly, and in walked three men, large men, strong men, men in police uniform who without fear stared at Mr. Hasty Hogan and Mr. Blackie Burns. What does this mean, Mr. Rogers? Asked Mr. Hogan. It's quite simple, said Mr. Rogers. It's just happened that I'm the chief of police.